Hello. In this short tutorial, we're going to build some GitHub Action workflows, the QA. If you've ever copied and pasted YAML between repositories only to get bitten by a typo after pushing, or struggled to keep your mono repo pipelines consistent, Q can fix that. No platform changes, you still run on GitHub Actions, you just author your workflows in Q instead of YAML. The key idea is that Q becomes your source of truth. Our YAML is now nothing more than a generated artifact. This means type safety, validation, and catching mistakes before you push. It means composition and reuse. You can share triggers, jobs, steps as Q modules. It means safe defaults, policy enforcement, and dry workflows that stay maintainable over time. You can adopt it incrementally and gain all of these benefits without giving up the parts of GitHub Actions that you already love. In this video, we'll cover the Q basics, use the Q Central registry, and set up your pipelines for success. By the end, you'll know how to replace brittle YAML with well-defined Q, keeping the good parts and removing some pain. Let's get started. So, before we start covering the basics of Q, it's important to know how you can get help for yourself on your Q journey. The first place you'll want to go to is q.dev/docs. There's also a link on screen now that takes you directly to the documentation for working with GitHub Actions. Now, let's get that terminal open. So, in our IDE, we have a main.q file that is currently empty. We're going to start by just putting package main, where we'll export the name David. If you squint at this, it kind of just looks like YAML with a package statement. The package statement, of course, from the heritage of Go, which is what the Q tooling is all written in. We then define the name David, and Copilot's jumping ahead and trying to define my age. But before we take a look at anything else, we'll just come here and run Q export. By default, Q exports in JSON. We can see here that we have a property called name, which has a string value of David. If we take Copilot's suggestion and just say that I am 30 years old, we could go back and export again, and we'll see here the age is a property with an integer value of 30. Now, the essence of Q is that we can have our schema and our data all living side by side to the point where we can see that this is an integer. If we set this to be the string value of 30, we get a conflict in value, mismatch types between int and string. So we can set it back to 30, but we can do so much more with the power of Q. We can say that we only allow ages greater than or equal to 18 and less than or equal to 120. Now, this is still correct until we go to 16, where we have an out-of-bound error, because, again, we set the constraints that the lower bound was 18. The upper value of 120 is fine, but 121 is not. Let's keep it back to 30 and move on. Now, as we can see here, we have some sort of shape to our data, right? This resembles a person. So why not just have a data type or definition in Q with data and schema that defines what a person is? We can say person equals, and we can grab this and put this here. Now, of course, we wouldn't want to define the name and the person itself, so we'll set this to string. And now we have a definition, a schema for what a person is. We could then say that we want to collect a list of people with the constraints of persons. We're looking for a list of persons. We could now pop open a list, and we'll let Copilot succeed in some regards here. We'll give it something where, say, we have Alice with an age, like so. We can come over and we could run Q export, and we see that we get the people list back with Alice. Something else that we can do with Q is use the vet command. QVet just validates that what we have is correct for the constraints that are defined. You can use QHelpVet to get more information on how to use this command, but we will use a few common variants as part of this tutorial. let's head back over to our data. Let's assume that we also need email addresses. We could say that this is of type string with a constraint, and given that the 4 second eyeball test, I'm going to say Copilot is not too far off. We're then going to add an email address, and I won't use mine. This is alice@rockcodeacademy. We can run over, do QVET, QExport, everything seems to be good. But what if we want to make the email address an optional field? Currently, if we remove the email address, we run QExport, we get an incomplete value, and the same for QVET. If we add -c as instructed, it just gives us the same warning saying that we're trying to get concrete values and it's failing because this is an incomplete value. So we can come to the email address, add a question mark, run qvet-c, qexport, and we're back to a working configuration. So let's dig into that a little bit more. Let's assume we have property A of int, B of string, and C, which is a list of ints. We're going to say that A is an optional field and B is a regular field, and we'll leave C as a regular field too. Now when we put together our Alice person, we'll leave A out and just add B with hello. We can then run qvet-c and everything is okay. There is no error. If we remove B, we now have an incomplete value. But you may be looking at B and C and saying that they're the same. And this is just down to the default value for a list being an empty list. Q has a way to work around this semantic with required fields. So optional, regular, which is the same, can be described as required on scalar values. But we then have the required exclamation mark to change the behavior for lists. Now, if we run this, B and C are incomplete. B we can set to hello, and C we can set to a list of integers, getting us back to our complete and happy value. It's now time to talk about the Q Central Registry. This is the relatively new effort from the Q team to make it easier to adopt Q for common workflows. If we search for GitHub Actions and click on the package, you'll see that we now have a bunch of definitions that we can import from the central registry to get instant validation against existing GitHub workflow YAML files or new and improved Q ones that we're going to write as part of this tutorial. We copy the identifier here and head back to our terminal. Now all we have is the main.q. So we do need to run qmod init. This creates a q.mod directory, meaning we can now do qmod get and paste in what we copied from the registry. We can now come to our code where we could delete all of our boilerplate thus far and say import GitHub Actions from q.dev. Now, what I could do is start to put together a workflow called deploy. I could indent it with workflow and say that workflow is of type GitHub Actions workflow. We could then come over, run qvet. It tells us we have incomplete values, which is expected because we're not defining any jobs or any triggers for the workflow. Now, what's important here is that we said workflow is a workflow. That's it, right? It's just an association between the definitions that we get from the Q Central Registry to this workflow property, where we then set the name, but again, we're not setting enough. Now, rather than typing all of this out line by line and working through the errors, we're going to take an alternative approach. That is, in this workflows directory, I have pulled in the real production Rockcode Academy website workflow. Now, there's two interesting things that we can do here. One is import, but the other is qvet. So let's head over to our terminal where we can run qvet. You can see I've already typed this command. We're looking for a complete value with -c. -d is shorthand for schema. We're saying we're going to use the workflow definition. And this comes from a Q package on the Q Central registry called GitHub Actions, and we pass the file that we want to validate. This tells me that my GitHub action workflow is fine. Of course, we can break this by removing a whole bunch of stuff. And now we're being told that we need on defined. So you can take your existing workflows and validate them before you push. Not only that, we can import this YAML to give us queue versions of our GitHub actions. So let's try workflows deploy and write this to workflows deploy.queue, not forgetting the queue at the start. We can then find deploy.queue, and now we have a queue representation. Okay, so while this is a valid queue workflow for GitHub Actions, we're not actually using any of the definitions and enforcing this with queueVit. So what we're going to do is first set up a package.main so that we can use this file with main.queue, which is now currently empty. We are going to import queue.dev GitHub Actions, just like we did previously. Now we need to be able to say that all of this is an instance of a definition. Why don't we just call this deploy, which is actually GitHub Actions workflow. Like so. We can stick the closing brace at the bottom and run queue format. And job done. If we run queuevit-c, everything is still valid. So now it's time to take some niceties of queue and clean up our config. Now, pushing on main is quite a common thing to do. So much so, I think we should have something called triggers, called push on main, which configures push branches main, like so. This means that we can come here, delete everything but the paths, and then grab them. We can then say on triggers.push on main, expand this type with our paths. We can format that up, and now we have this. So if we run kubevit, it fails drastically. And that's just because we need push paths, not just paths. And we're back to valid. So right away, we've found a way to set up a commonality, a trigger that can be reused across other workflows. Now you may notice here that all of the paths on our pushes and our pull requests are also the same. So we can also say that source paths are our two paths and set them like so. Again, if we run kubevit, things look pretty good. Now, if we export as YAML and write this to a file with a forced overwrite an existing file, we can then say deploy.yaml and workflows diff are two different files. Now, as we can see, there are an awful lot of differences here. And if we pop open this one, you'll see that our source paths have snuck in and our entire workflow is nested under deploy, which is not what our original workflow had. So we need to modify our export to support this use case. If we pull up our export command again, we can pass an expression to say that we only want to write the deploy property, in this case our workflow, to the file. And if we open this, this looks much cleaner already. If we try the diff, you'll see it is superficial errors with quoting of strings and the comments which are not imported by queue import. So currently, our workflow in queue and in YAML is correct. But of course, we can continue to iterate on this. So let's do one more together. So let's head back to deploy.queue and let's talk about security and salsa compliance, or at least skim over the boring stuff and do the fun queue bits. Down here, we have a step for performing a checkout. Pretty much every GitHub Actions workflow has this step and drift between versions, even if you are using versions V3, 4, whatever, But best practice is to pin this to a share from the repository. And it's hard to do across repositories, but it's still even hard to do in repositories because it requires updating all of the shares on each workflow, depending on how many workflows you have. And well, Dependabot will do its best to try and keep these up to date for you. Maybe using a queue module via the registry or just in a config or main.queue like we're using today is a better approach. So let's take our action and say actions checkout, which is equal to this. Now, I have gone ahead and grabbed a SHA in advance, so we can just save this file. We can run queue format, pop back, and this looks pretty good. We can go back to our deploy.queue, and now here we delete this. And we could just say actions.checkout, like so. And I'm not sure how queue is going to format that, so why not? Let's not guess. Okay, but does this vet, and is it still valid? We can run vet-c, it looks good. We can continue with our export of deploy, and we can run our diff. And what we'll see here is that we have went from actions v4, or actions checkout v4, to our new SHA address. And as I said, this could live in the queue central registry, where your whole team can publish their Salsa compliance approved versions. Now, outside of our main deploy.queue, we've actually lost any validation or verification that this is a correct type. But we can come to the central registry for GitHub Actions, step for uses, because we know that is a known property. And if we scroll up, we'll see that we have a GitHub Actions step. So we can use this type here by saying GitHub actions dot step and just importing q.dev GitHub actions v0. Now if we run qvet-c, everything is still valid. You could do the same for your triggers and anything else that you want to make reusable as well. Now I have behind the scenes made a few more changes to deploy.queue. So let's go take a look at other improvements you can make to your GitHub Actions workflows using queue. So if we scroll down deploy.queue, we now have runs on Ubuntu. Well, not saving us any lines of code, just a slightly nicer experience than having to work with the runs on Ubuntu strings. We then have an action to install Dagger. So we no longer have to remember the command for that. And simplifying how to run a Dagger shell. Because all of these Dagger shells run in the same directory for this project, really all we need is a name and the Dagger shell that we want to run. And then lastly, here we have conditions.pushOnMain. This is gating or protecting our deployment Dagger shell command to deploy the production website unless it is a pushOnMain. If we pop open the main.queue, we have our runs on Ubuntu. We have our Dagger install, which is just the GitHub Actions step. We have our Dagger shell, which just sets the working directory, and my AA keyboard is getting very frustrating. And we have conditions push on main, which sets the if condition to check the branch, the reference, or workflow dispatch. And again, we're just scratching the surface of the things you can do with queue. And that's how you can improve your GitHub Actions with queue. You can use the queue registry to pull in the GitHub Actions types. Not only that, you can publish your own helpers to the registry too. Make them available for everyone within your team, your organization, or even share them with the world. Then you can write your GitHub Actions in queue, making them ergonomic and dry. Because who doesn't want to reduce boilerplate? It'll make you hate GitHub Actions and it'll make you hate YAML that little bit less on every deploy. All you have to do is remember to use queue export and save your GitHub Actions. But of course, you can automate that too, making sure your CI fails when your queue and your YAML diverge. I hope this session piqued your interest. I hope you're excited to learn queue and explore queue for GitHub Actions. Have a great day.